We're in the middle of a series that is running for throughout the rest of October. It started in September. I guess it's called, and it just is a reflection, that for every one of us, there's a first time for something. There's a first time for something in our lives. Maybe there's things that you hope to do, want to do, wish to do, hope you could do. Well, maybe today is the first time for that. For all of us, I trust and pray that today will be the first time for God to encounter you in a new way and for you to have your eyes open to see him in a fresh way today. There's a first time for everything. As we look through the book of Joshua, that's where we're going. It's an Old Testament record of how the Israelites came into the inheritance that had been given to them by God of the nation that we now know as Israel. And as you know, they'd been kept in captivity for 400 years and been under slavery in the nation of Egypt and had broken out of slavery some 40 years before the story that we're about to read today. And as they did that, then they were caught in the wilderness because of their disobedience and their lack of response to God. And it made them waste a whole generation wandering round and round. I trust that none of us in this room this afternoon are wandering round and round because we continually are bumping up against God and not wanting to do what he wants us to do. But after 40 years, they came again to a moment of first times, I guess. And in chapter 3, there's written a story, a statement that God said to the people, said, when you cross this river, because you've never gone this way before, keep an eye out on the Ark of the Covenant, the box which was the representation of the presence of God. Keep your eyes on that, because you don't know where you're going. And if you keep your eyes on that, you'll do something and you'll go somewhere for the very first time, because you've never been this way before. And for all of us in this room today, we've never been the way of tomorrow before. Tomorrow has never happened for any of us yet. We don't know what we're going to get tomorrow. We don't know what news we're going to waken up to tomorrow. We don't know what information is coming our way. We don't know what's going to happen inside our bodies and around us tomorrow and this week. But you see, there's a first time for everything. And this morning, it may well be there's a first time for you to trust God in a brand new way, to see him in a brand new way. What I want to talk about this morning for just a few moments together is there's a first time for us to submit our lives. There's a first time for submission. It's a word that I guess conjures up a whole bunch of ideas in our minds and our hearts, some good, some not so good. I remember the very first time that I had experienced what submission felt like. I was about 10, maybe 11, 10 or 11, and I was in school, and there was this young man called Brian. He was, not a friend, but he was an associate. He was in my class at school. And we played football together. We did things together in the class. We played games as you did as a little 10, 11-year-old boy. But I must have said something perhaps against his intellectual capacity or the strange odor that used to follow him around or maybe his residence or his paternity. I said something that obviously caused him to be somewhat irritated, shall we say. And so I didn't think much of it, but obviously he thought something of it. And the first thing I remember was his right fist hitting the side of my head. And as that fist hit the right side of my head, another fist hit the left side of my head. And then off we went on a series of fists hitting Iain's head. And that carried on for several minutes, actually, as he pulled my pullover up over my head and caught me in some kind of trap, and then feet went, and then arms went, and fists went, and I wasn't a brawler by any manner of means. I was only 10. I'm only just a little boy. But this was the first significant and serious scrap that this little boy was involved in. And I was getting some significant beating, I would have to say. And he was punching and kicking and all these, and anatomy was going all over the place. And I was the receiving end of that. And eventually he got me down on the ground. And as he got me down on the ground, I remember my face suggested it was time to give up. And I think my head suggested it was time to give up. My arm suggested it's time to give up. And eventually my mouth said, I submit, I submit. But that was after I was several bits of black and blue and swollen bits. And we would say back home where I was, I took a real dunting. I got a real hiding. I was well beaten up. But it was the first time that I remember declaring and saying, I submit, I submit, I surrender. I can't deal with it anymore. Yes, you are stronger. Yes, you are more powerful. Yes, your fists are better than mine. Yes, you're faster than I am. Yes, your weight on my chest is bigger than who I am. I'm just a little boy. Oh, I'm looking for a bit of sympathy here. You're sitting here silent. You're giving me nothing. Sounds like, hey, you deserve it. I'm looking for a bit of something here, a little bit of comfort and an arm around me or something. I know, exactly, I am. I'm bleeding all over you and you're sitting, so what? It was the first time ever that I said, I submit. Submission is in our lives all the time, every day. Some of you submitted to your hunger this morning and have breakfast. Some of you submitted to your tiredness last night and went to bed. Some of you submit to feelings all the time. Some of you submit to the boss that is around you. Some of you submit to a husband or a wife, perhaps who's unfair to you or unjust to you. Some of you submit to the contract of employment that you have. Some of you even submit to the speed limit as you drive your car. There's all manner of things around us and within us that we submit to. Submission, as you know, is just that sense of yielding or surrendering or laying down or accepting and affirming that somebody else else's will is stronger and more superior than yours, that there's an authority that is greater than yours, that there is a force that is stronger than yours. And you know, as men and women who follow Jesus and who follow God, we need to acknowledge that we are under submission to God and his laws, but it also invites us to be submitted one to another. I think all of us are in that place where we all have battles and all have fights and all have strongholds and all have difficulties and all have challenges that we fight with every day in our lives. Some of them are internal, some of them are external, but they exist in all of our lives. I'd be shocked if, looking around the room this afternoon, we don't all carry some level of stronghold in our lives or some level of at least walls and barriers that are in our lives that stop us from being who we dream we'll be or stop us from achieving what we want to achieve or going where we want to go. I don't know what they may well be in your life, but it may well be some of those habits that you've got yourself into. And that habit has now become such a stronghold in your life that a wall has built up and you can't get over it. It may be the hurts and the pain that you've encountered in your life, and the hurts have risen so much and the pain is so high that it's now a wall that you can't get through. It may be just your inadequacy, that you feel you're unable to do that which you're supposed to do, and every time there's an invitation, then you fall flat on your face again, and inadequacy rises as a stronghold. For some, it may well just be apathy, that you go through the motions of your life all the time. And you wish you were different, you wish you were more enthused, you wish you were more engaged, but apathy is that stronghold. You can't seem to break it free. Perhaps for others it's pride, that I will do it myself. Don't you tell me how I should live my life. Don't you tell me and direct me what I should do, when I should do it, and how I should do it. I'm my own boss, and I will live my life the way I live it. And now within you is this kind of stronghold that says, this is who I am, and this is the wall that is ahead. For others, it's external things. Sometimes it's the negativity around you or that boss that's very strong. Sometimes it is the pain in your family and difficulty. There are so many difficult things that actually are the stronghold and the wall that is erected that you face battle every day. Sometimes we try to get around it or over it or under it or through it. And this morning, this afternoon, we're just going to talk a few minutes and read from a story which is now 3,000 years old. Which I guess is a story that we all love to know. It's the story of the Jericho walls falling down. There's even a song about it. You know, Joshua fought the battle of Jericho, Jericho. Yeah? No? Nobody know it? Yeah, okay, that's enough. But just to paint the picture, it's a story that I guess both from mythology and from childhood or whatever, most of us will have heard a story of Jericho walking, the Israelites walking around this city called Jericho, and the walls come tumbling down. But there's truth in this story that I think is important for us. We often think the story is a story about conquering the strongholds, tearing down the walls, breaking through the barriers, but actually, as we'll see in a moment, it's actually a story of sequential submission. It's a story about submission. Joshua submitting to God. The people and the leaders submitting to Joshua and to God. And the wall submitting to the plans of God and to Joshua and to the people. And eventually the enemy that was contained within those walls submitting to God and submitting to the Israelites as they traveled around. It's a story of sequential submission. And maybe today you're in this room and actually God wants to grab your attention because there's a first time for everything, and maybe today it's a first time for a fresh submission in your life. So let's go and we'll read a little bit from chapter 5, end of chapter 5 and chapter 6. It'll come up on the screen behind, and we'll just talk through a few of these observations from this story. It says, when In chapter 6 and verse 1, just to set the scene, it says, "Now Jericho was tightly shut up because of the Israelites. No one went out and no one came in." They were expecting a siege. They were expecting a long journey of battle and fight. And maybe you've been on a long journey where, as it were, that large habit within you, that significant pain, that significant blockage in your thinking, that emotional disturbance that is within you has grown so large that now there's a fight, there's a battle. It's gone on for years and you've never broken free. It's almost like Jericho. The doors are shut and nothing was getting in and nothing was getting out. They were expecting a long siege. And almost it's our inner self that sets itself up for this long battle. It says, you'll never conquer this. You'll never get over this. You're never going to break through. You're never going to become anything that you're not at the moment. The way you think at the moment is the way you're always going to think. The way that you behave and what you do is always the way you're going to. Take me on, as it were. I'm going to fight for forever. Jericho, you see, was a city-state. It was around, I guess, 10 acres in size. It wasn't massive. It perhaps would have taken all of us maybe an hour at most to walk around the perimeter. But it was a very impregnable sight. It was a very fearful and scary sight for all of these Israelites that were emerging out of Egypt. It was the first city they'd ever seen. They'd never seen a city before. They just wandered around the wilderness, and this was their first encounter, a city whose walls were 30 feet high and 6 feet wide. And so they had two walls. One was 30 feet high and 6 foot wide. The other one was 30 feet high and 12 foot wide. And in between, there was a walkway that chariots and horses could run, and houses were built into it. It was very significant. It was impregnable. It was impossible. Nobody would have ever thought they would ever be able to break through. And so the folks in Jericho at the top of the hill would have thought, hey, we're here for a long haul. These Israelites, no matter what they do, they will never get through. They will never be able to break in. And that's why it says in verse 1 of chapter 6, it was tightly shut up because of the Israelites. And at the same time, in chapter 5, verse 13, it describes what Joshua was doing. It says, "Now when Joshua was near Jericho, he looked up and says, and he saw a man standing in front of him with a drawn sword in his hand. Joshua went up to him and asked, 'Are you for us? Are you for our enemies?' 'Neither,' the man replied, 'but as commander of the army of the Lord, I've now come.' Then Joshua fell face down on the ground in reverence and asked him, 'What message does my Lord have for his servant?' The commander of the Lord's army replied, 'Take off your sandal, for the place where you are standing is holy.' And Joshua did so." Verse 2, "Then the Lord said to Joshua, 'See, I have delivered Jericho into your hands.'" See, take a look, watch, observe. "I have delivered Jericho into your hands, along with its king and its fighting men. Now this is what I want you to do. March around the city once with all the armed men. Do this for 6 days. Make 7 priests carry trumpets of ram's horns in front of the ark. On the 7th day, march around the city 7 times with the priests blowing the trumpets. And when you hear them sound a long blast in the trumpets, make all the people give a loud shout. Then when the wall of the city will collapse and the people will go up, every man straight in." So Joshua, son of Nun, called the priests and said to them, "Lift up the ark of the covenant of the Lord, and make 7 priests carry trumpets in front of it." And he ordered the people, "Advance, march around the city with the armed guard going ahead of the ark of the Lord." And then it goes on and tells the story how Joshua then gathered all the people and said, "I don't want you to say a sound. I don't want you to speak. I don't want you to do anything. You're just going to do this. You're going to march around once every day for 6 days. And on the 7th day, you're going to do the same, but you're going to start up early. You're going to miss your Weetabix, and you're going to go out and you're going to walk around 7 times that day. And at the end of the time, there'll be a sound and there'll be the blast of the trumpet. And at that point, I want you to shout. And as you shout, the wall will come down, and then you can charge in and take control and take charge of the city. Take out that which is holy to me, silver, gold, but the rest I want you to remove and I want you to annihilate." And then he said, "Remember Rahab. Rescue Rahab because she helped us." And that basically is the story. It's a story which is exciting. It's a story that I'm sure you've seen TV stuff and cartoons and different things that portrays this story. But actually, the main theme of this story is a story of submission. And I wonder today if there's a first time for submission in your life. I believe there's 3 just simple observations and stages that we can observe the journey of submission in all of our life. Number 1 is submission starts by looking up and falling down. Submission starts by looking up and falling down. Joshua, it says, was walking near the city of Jericho. But I'm sure that as he was walking near in his physical life, He was walking inside in his mental life. I don't know if you do that, but I do it all the time. You may be physically here, but you're dreaming and thinking of who I could be over there. You're thinking of what your life can be like, if onlys. If what ifs I could break through that, my life would be like this. If only I didn't have that thing constantly at my side, constantly pulling me down. If I constantly didn't have that barrier and that stronghold that had such a hold of me, this is who I would be. This is the man I would be. This is how I would be carrying my life and doing my life and prioritizing my life. So Joshua was no different. I'm sure he was walking around thinking about, how am I going to get to that place? Where is the wall that is between where I am and where I want to be? All of us in this room today have got a desire and a dream, I'm sure, of over there. But between over there and where we're at here is something called a wall, is something called a stronghold, is something called a barrier. And Joshua was no different. He was walking around. And we see that the Bible says that he looked up. If it says he looked up, obviously his gaze was not upward. Maybe his gaze was downward. Maybe his gaze was where he's at here and now, looking at his feet, looking at himself, concerned with who he was, concerned with his own inadequacies, concerned with the present situation, concerned with all the things that he didn't have, all the man that he wasn't, everything that he didn't have and he didn't contain. He didn't have a strategy at this point. He didn't have a plan. He didn't know how he was going to get from here to there. He was just in this place. Perhaps he was looking just down at where he was in the here and now and in the present. Perhaps he was looking around him. Perhaps he was seeing how big these walls are and measuring out and thinking, man, if that is 30 feet high, it's going to take this amount of force to get through there. Maybe he was working out what the circumstances around him looked like. How big was the wall? How small was his army? How large was the wall and how difficult without weapons? Maybe the circumstances around him was what his gaze was on. Maybe that's where his focus was, on the issues that were in his world. Sometimes our life is like that. We're so focused on ourselves, so focused on the situation and how I'm feeling and what's going on in my life and my own inadequacies and my own imperfections and my own difficulties. Sometimes it's difficult to see what God wants you to see. Sometimes it's because we're so overtaken by the circumstances around us. The difficulties seem so large, the walls so high, the barriers so great, the difficulty so insurmountable that there's no way that we're going to ever get through, no way that we're ever going to be where God wants us to be, no way we're ever going to get where we want to be. Perhaps Joshua was looking back. Perhaps he was looking back to where he'd come from, remembering the good old days. Don't you love doing that? The older I get, the sadder I become. Constantly reflecting on what has gone past. It all seems like yesterday, and yet time passes so fast. But so many of us actually spend time looking back on what was. Either we spend time trying to mend all the regrets that we've got, all the decisions that we've made, all the things that we wish we hadn't done, or we look back with, wasn't it wonderful when? Wasn't it wonderful when church was much smaller and everybody knew each other and it was lovely and intimate and cozy and there were no hassles and everybody just was aware of who everybody was and it was just so sweet and so nice and everything was just great. Oh, maybe we could go back to that. Joshua maybe was looking back to the Jordan River and thinking, I don't know, we can't go back there. The river is now closed. We can't go back to Egypt. We can't go back. But sometimes our lives are occupied looking back rather than looking up. But if we want to start and make that first stage of submission, it starts by looking up. Looking up, it says, he had a brand new perspective. He said he looked up and he saw a man standing. Initially, he thought, who is this? Who is this man? And he said, are you for us or are you against us? And the response was, I am neither, but I am the commander of the armies of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and I'm here right now, and this is who I am. I'm here to take charge. I'm here to be in control. I'm here to tell you what needs to be told. I'm here to be the one who's going to give you every solution that you need. I'm going to be the one who's going to take you from where you are to where you need to be. I'm present in your problems. I'm the one who's bringing clarity in your uncertainty. I'm the one who's going to invite you and encourage you to take your eyes off the walls, take your eyes off the circumstances, take your eyes off your feet and look up to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Today, submission starts by looking up and getting a fresh perspective on who is our God. A fresh perspective on the one who's the commander of the army of the Lord of hosts. David knew him and knew him well. And you remember in Psalm 24, he says very clearly these words. He said, lift up your heads, you gates. Be lifted up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? He's the Lord, strong, mighty. He's the Lord who's strong in battle. Lift up your heads. Lift him up that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? He's the Lord Almighty. He is the King of glory. Who do you look up to today? Who is the one that you're looking up and lifting your gaze off the circumstances, off the walls, off the difficulties? We're invited, the start of submission is to look up and see who's in charge. Look up who's leading your life. Look up and see who's the one who knows every issue in your world. Whether it's the non, you can't get that visa, look up and see who's got that in control. If it's you don't have enough finances, look up and see who's the one who's got all the money. If you don't have all the health, look up and see the one who's the healer. If you don't have that relationship together, look up and see the one who is the come as the reconciler. If you don't have freedom, look up to see the one who's the bondage breaker and the one who can set you free. Today, it's our opportunity to submit by looking up and seeing again who is the King and who is the Lord in your life. Who's the one who's in charge? Is it yourself? Is it the issues and the fears and the anxieties? Is it your own concern? Where are you looking at today? The start of submission starts by having a fresh perspective and looking up. Take your eyes off your feet. Take your eyes off your circumstances. Turn your eyes on Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of the earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and the light of his grace. Where are you looking today? There's an encouragement for all of us to look up. But it's not only about changing our perspective and looking up, it's actually about changing our position and falling down. It says of Joshua that once he looked up, it says, then Joshua fell face down on the ground in reverence. That should be our response today. Looking up and seeing who is the King of Kings, we should respond by falling down. It's about looking up and falling down. Where are you today? What's the position of your life today? It changed his position. Every looking up and seeing who is God should be accompanied by a falling down and seeing who we are. Watchman Nee was a wonderful missionary who was in China for most of the last century. Born in 1903, died in 1971, and planted so many churches in China. But he said these wonderful words. He said, it's not until we take our place as servant that he takes his place as Lord. Can I say that again? It's not until we take our place as servant that God takes his place as Lord. You see, when Joshua hit the ground, several things happened. When you hit the ground, his hands went up, I'm sure, and said, I surrender. When I was a little boy, we used to play cowboys and Indians. I know you don't do that anymore. It's probably politically incorrect anyway. But we used to play cowboys and Indians. And when my friends would come with guns and they would bang, if I was an Indian, they would bang, 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 and I would, oh, so I surrender. That's what you did. You lifted your hands. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? Yeah, you'd lift your hand. I know all you guys played on this kind of stuff and you blew somebody's brains and there was blood all over the place. It was a better day in my day. We just used to say, bang, 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 you're dead. And you say, I surrender. That's how it was. But that's what it means. When we fall, it says, I surrender, I worship, and I acknowledge you are God and I am not. That's what he's saying. He fell in reverence down on the ground. It's worshiping God. It's that place that says, it's more than my songs. It's more than my tithe. It's more than my time. It's more than just conforming to what we do together. That's not worship. Worship is the conforming of my will to his. Worship, the best illustration of worship is our obedience. You know, when Simon said today, come on, let's lift our hands, is a mark, I guess, of surrender that says, I surrender to you, God. You're greater than I am. In that moment, there was a challenge for all of us, because not all of us lifted our hands. You see, what happens in that moment is that submission becomes right focused in front of you. What are you going to submit to? What's the greater power that you submit to? Is it the tradition that says within you, we don't lift our hands? Is it the emotion that says, everybody will look at me, I don't lift my hands? Is it the difficulty that says, I can't lift my hands? Is it the embarrassment that says, I'm not going to lift my hands? Is it something inside that says, nobody's going to tell me from the front that I'm going to lift my hands? What is it? But you see, all of us submit to something. So there's another voice inside that says, my tradition voice is louder, or my feelings voice is louder, or my what will people think voice is louder. So when it's just a simple invitation, it says, come on, let's declare with hands lifted up, we're waiting here for you. And so many didn't. That's just a reflection on submission. You see, I'm not talking about lifting hands. I'm talking about submitting hearts. I'm talking about bowing our knees. I'm talking about our spirits in reverence to God saying, I surrender. You are God and I am not. You see, there's more than that. He said, it's not only about surrendering, it's actually about subtracting that which stops us. He said to Joshua, I need you to take that sandal off your feet. because this is a holy place. My presence is a holy place. And your shoe leather is the barrier between us at this moment. Your shoe leather, that which you're standing on, is preventing us and me from being in your world. My presence, you can't stand in my presence because you've got shoe leather on your foot. Take that sandal off your foot. It was an illustration of a transaction that used to happen in the olden times when somebody recognized there was somebody greater around them. And it was a statement that said, I can't, but you can. Whether it was finance, if there was a house to be bought and two people would go there and the one person would say, I don't have enough money to buy it. The other one would say, oh, well, I do. And the one who didn't have enough money said, would take his shoe off and say, well, here's the transaction. I can't buy it, but you can. You'll read it in Ruth chapter 4 and verse 6 to 8. And basically what God was having this conversation and saying, you know what, there are barriers in all your lives. There's barriers in your life, Joshua, that you need to remove, whatever it is. For him, it's shoe leather. I don't know what it is in our world today. I don't know what it is in your life. I know there's things in my life that God's saying, you need to subtract that and take that away if you want to be somebody who's going to submit and surrender to me. It's when we get to the end of ourselves that God steps in. You know that phrase, and everybody knows it, our extremity becomes God's opportunity. But we need to not wait till we get to our extremity. Let's invite our extremity to us and say, I can't do this on my own. I can't live this Christian faith. I can't be this person that I'm asked to be. I can't do the things that I'm asked to do. I don't have it within me. And so therefore, I'm going to submit. Take that barrier that is within us away and remove it, that I surrender. And I lift up my eyes and see who's God, and I fall down and acknowledge that you are King. It's about lifting up, I beg your pardon, it's about looking up and falling down. But it's also about lifting up and stepping out. Can you just imagine the picture when Joshua gathers all the priests and the army together and he says, okay, I've got a plan. They're all thinking, oh yes, here we go. This is what is going to happen. It's going to be either, Joshua, do we need to lift up your hands like you lifted up Moses' hands and then we'll bash on in and we'll get through? Is that what we're going to do? Or are we going to be ramming our way through? Or are we going to be digging a tunnel through? What are we going to be doing, Joshua? What are we going to be doing? Well, actually, gentlemen, you're going to be blowing some trumpets and walking silently. You can just imagine they'll be thinking, have you eaten some mushrooms or something? Where are you getting this from? Where are you getting those crazy thoughts from? Not only would they be saying to him, this is crazy thoughts, these are actually dangerous thoughts. They're up here and we're down here and we're only walking around. They'll fire at us. They'll say things to us. They'll attack us. And you want us just to walk around? This is ridiculous, Joshua. There are many things in our lives that may well seem ridiculous, may well seem not logical and sensical to us, may not, I guess, tie in with what we think we should do. But that's when, what are we going to do, becomes the question. Who are we going to submit to at that point? Is it maybe today the first time to submit in your life to that which you've never submitted before? Maybe you have looked up and fallen down and worshipped. But I would encourage you, it's more than that. It's about lifting up and stepping out. Joshua says, lift up the ark. We've already seen that. That's a common result for them. Lift up the ark. Elevate the ark. What is first? What is the highest place in your life? The ark was the physical representation of the presence of God. And in it, you know, there were these three things. There was the jar which contained the manna, the expression that God had provided for them every step of the journey thus far. For the last 40 years, they'd provided manna, and there was a sample of that in a little jar inside this box. So that it was a picture of God's constant provision. And that would remind them, say, yes, that's right. He is a God who provides. He is a God who makes available that which I need day by day, moment by moment. And then there was the Ten Commandments, that which was for their preservation. If you live like this, then you will live well. If you submit to these commands that I've got in here, then your life will go well. It's for your preservation. Oh, yeah, the Ten Commandments in there. They help us to set boundaries in our lives, to know what is the right thing to do and not to do. And there's a staff in there, the staff of Moses. The staff that opened the Red Sea, the staff that brought water from the rock, expression of God's power. And you see, the Joshua was saying, lift up that expression of God's power. Lift up that expression of God's preservation in your life. Lift up that expression of God's provision for you. And then you can step out. Then you can, with conviction, move forward. Because for the Israelites, who did they believe in? Where did they put their trust? Where was their faith? Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 30 says, it was by faith that the children of Israel broke through and took down the walls of Jericho. It was by faith that they did that. It wasn't by strength. It wasn't by might. It was by their conviction and trust in the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. What are you standing on today? What is it that your faith is based on? You know, I couldn't believe it the other day. I put in a thing on here, pressed it, and I said to Siri, where's the nearest restaurant? And back came an answer from Siri, yeah?
Okay, here's what I found.
It's McDonald's. The thing is, we trust this little electronic box to give us information. We put our faith in this little electronic box with a whole bunch of little bits, turn right, turn left, go here, go there, all this kind of stuff. We trust this. We put our faith in a box. But God is reminding you and I today, who is it we're putting our faith in? Where is it where is our conviction lying? Where is our faith lying? Because faith obeys when even the explanation isn't very clear. For them, the explanation wasn't clear, but faith was the thing that took them forward. It was faith that trampled over all the ridicule. It was faith that trampled over all the uncertainty and their own inadequacy and the impossibility. It was faith that took them through all the opposition. It was faith that took them through stupidity. And it's faith that can take you through all the obstacles that you've got in your life. It's trusting and putting your conviction in God as the one who is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. It's faith and trust in Him. It's lifting Him up that encourages you and I to progress, to step forward, to take that first step. And today maybe God is saying to you, it's time to submit and to take that first step. I don't know what that step is, but for them it literally was walking by faith. Literally, they were walking forward, not knowing what the future was going to be. Literally, they were walking forward, not knowing if victory was going to be theirs, but they put their trust in a God. They submitted to that which they'd been told, and they obeyed. Simple obedience, nothing difficult, but obedience is the biggest illustration of worship in your life and in my life. Can I say to you that the progression in your life is actually dependent on the conviction of your life, which will always be shaped by the elevation of Him in your life. I'll say that again to you. The progression of your life will be dependent upon the conviction of what you have as God in your life, and will always be shaped by the degree to which you elevate the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You need to look up and fall down. We need to lift up and step out, but also we need to let go and walk on. Submission, we often think for many of us, is a moment. It's a thing that we do. It's a battle that we face. It's a decision we make right here, right now, and it's for a moment. It's almost like you're driving your car and you put it into neutral and the inertia of your car takes you forward. But it's always that you know, I'm going to put it in gear again and I'm going to go where the car wants to go and where I want to take it. And sometimes we think our life is like that. Okay, I'll submit and I'll go into neutral and then I'll just be taken where God wants me to go. But actually, the time will come when I'll put it back in gear and then we'll go where I want to go again. And so many of our lives, we can look back and see how many times we've gone in neutral and how many times we put back in gear. Neutral, back in gear. Neutral, back in gear. Yes? Where we take the reins back again and we steer the car ourselves. Then we put it back into neutral and let God take us as we submit to Him. For the children of Israel, you can imagine on day one, the excitement. They've been told that if you just walk around silently and if you just do what you're supposed to do, if you just listen to the trumpet blast and walk around, then God's going to do what God's going to do. And they're all excited, think, fantastic. An hour later, they're finished, and they go back to camp. What was that about? Is that it? Well, okay, Joshua, that's fine. They get up the next morning, off they go again, and they do the same thing on day two. They do the same thing on day three. They do the same thing on day four, and they do the same thing on day five. By day six, I think they're beginning to say, Joshua, I think you've missed it. I think our enthusiasm we had on day one has kind of waned. Are you sure you got it right, Joshua? Are you sure this is what we're supposed to be doing? Are you sure this is what we're supposed to be submitting to? Are you sure this is the right way we're supposed to be living our life? I think you've missed it, Joshua. And you know what? I'm tired of this. I'm tired of every day just going down doing the same thing again. It failed yesterday. It failed the day before. It's going to fail again. There's no point in us doing this because it never is going to bring success. You can imagine those conversations beginning to rise within the children of Israel. And please don't blow that trumpet anymore. I'm fed up of that same tune day in, day out, day in, day out. And yet God would say to the children of Israel and to us, actually, it'll only be complete when I say it's complete. It'll only be done when I say it's done. It's no surprise that it was 7 days. It's no surprise it was 7 priests. It's no surprise it was 7 trumpets, because each time 7 is mentioned in the Bible as opposed to 6, 7 is that picture of completion, of fulfillment, of God doing what God is going to do. He made the earth in 6 days, rested on the 7th, because it was complete. And yet, for us, sometimes we don't see that. But God is looking to say to you and to me, there is a time that I will bring to completion the end of your barrier, the end of your stronghold. It will come down. All I need you to do is keep on walking. Keep on walking. Let go of your consternation. Keep on walking. It maybe doesn't seem right. Keep on walking. You may be tired and disappointed. Keep on walking. You maybe have the notion that the leaders have let you down. Keep on walking. Friends are maybe not there to help you. Keep on walking. The road seems rough. Keep on walking. You may even feel you're not being noticed. Keep on walking. Hey, you're going round and round in circles. Keep on walking. God is looking for you and I just to keep on that daily walk. Daily walking. The Bible calls it abiding in Him. Are you continuing to walk? Because it's the daily submission. Submission is not a moment. It's a lifestyle. For the children of Israel, it was about letting go and walking on. But their walking on resulted in them walking in and taking that which was theirs. Isn't it interesting to note that the coming down of the walls was not the end of the victory? The coming down of the walls was not the end of the story. The coming down and the removal of the barrier was not the end of the story. They had to go in and destroy that which was behind the wall. They had to take away and remove completely that which was behind. And sometimes we think, whoa, God, what kind of God are you that tells an army to go in and slaughter all the men and all the women and all the boys and all the girls, all those that seem to be innocent, and yet you're telling it to go in and slaughter. And throughout the Old Testament, you'll see story after story of God inviting people to go in and slaughter and kill and remove. Sometimes we forget, don't we, that because of God's grace, there is also God's judgment. On one side is grace, and on the other side is judgment. On the one side is forgiveness, and on the other side is wrath. You see, for these folks that were living in Jericho, they'd had a whole generation to submit. It says in chapter 2, it says in verse 9, I know that the Lord has given this land to you, and a great fear of you has fallen on us, because we remember how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you to come out of Egypt. They knew what kind of God was coming their way. They knew what God had done a generation before. They'd had a generation to submit, to bow the knee and to say, you are God, to lift up their eyes and see that He was God, to fall down before them and surrender, to lift up the placement of God and put Him first, to step out into that place of surrender and say, yes, we as a nation surrender to you. God had even given them 6 more days of grace as the Israelites had walked in full view round every day. Or the Jericho people could have certainly surrendered, could have certainly submitted. One family did. Family of Rehob that we talked about last week. One family with the same information said, I'm going to submit. I'm going to surrender. I look up and see a different picture. I see a God who's in charge and in control and sovereign. So therefore, I'm going to fall down and submit. I see a God that I need to lift up to the primary place in my life, and then I'm going to step out in faith and believe that He's going to do what He says He's going to do and rescue me and my family. Rahab did it. The whole city could have done it. See, there's a challenge for all of us in this room today. And sometimes we think grace is so easy, and God is always going to let people off the hook. He's constantly going to just let people off the hook. But we forget that Isaiah 53 says it was because of our sin that Jesus died. He paid the price for you and for me. Let me just read some of these words as we close today. And we talk about submission. In chapter 53, we all know it very well. But he writes these words. He says, but He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon Him. And by His wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. Every one has turned to his own way, and the Lord God has laid on Him, Jesus, the iniquity of us all. He says that He was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgression of my people, He was stricken. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter. It was the Lord's will to crush Him and cause Him to suffer. You know what? We sang about it this morning. It's called the scandal of grace. And we need to acknowledge that the scandal of grace cost Jesus giving his life away for you and for me. The people in Jericho, ultimately they submitted. They submitted by their lives being given. God has already said to all of us that because Jesus died and gave his life for us, he's now seated at the right hand, exalted forevermore. And he's been given a name above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. That day of submission is coming for all of us. None of us are going to escape that day of submission when all of us will bow the knee. When all of us will declare that Jesus is Lord. When all of us will look up and say, yes, you are Lord. And all of us will fall down at his feet. When all of us will lift up him to the highest place and declare that he is God. And all of us will have that trust and faith in him if we've put our trust and faith in him here. And so the journey of success, the journey of defeat of the strongholds in your life and in my life, this journey of the walls coming down is dependent upon our submission. If you've got a wall in your life today, if you have got a stronghold in your life today, you know what success starts with? Success starts with submission. And maybe this is the first time for everything. Maybe today is the first time for you to submit your life in a new and in a fresh way. Maybe today, for those of you who follow Jesus and have put him as Lord of your life, maybe today it's to lift him up again as Lord. Maybe today it's to look up again and acknowledge that he is God. Maybe today it's for you to fall on your face and once again surrender those areas of your life that you know are not surrendered. What is the shoe leather that's keeping you from God's presence? Maybe that has to go today. Maybe there's people in here and you've never actually ever submitted to God. You've never acknowledged that he is God, the Lord of your life. Then just in a moment, maybe the Lord would come to you and say, hey, it's time to submit. Look up and see who I am. A God who's for you and not against you. Let's pray this morning, can we?